Okay, so communication system as part of your fifth semester is, as I told, it's about dealing with communication aspects of engineering. So far, you have studied a few parts of this communication course. Can anybody quote me what part you have learned already right from your first semester? Yes, I said.
Frequency modulation.
Have you gone through frequency modulation in your first semester? Or not? Or you have been introduced with just amplitude modulation?
So we have frequency modulation as well.
Okay.
So we have both.
Okay, so you had basics of modulation already, but I'm not too sure that how far it has been dealt with in a both mathematical and conceptual way. So our part is about modulation to begin with. This course, we will definitely talk about modulation, but we'll take a long leap, just not about modulation, we'll take a bigger leap to understand more insights about communication theory. Okay, this is not just a theory, or it is just not a system. There are more things which can be decorated along with decoration. In the sense, I mean, so which can be utilized, to simulate some of the mathematical interpretations which come in this course. Okay, so I'll take a few minutes to recapitulate what you have been introduced so far, so that it will act as a kind of a warm up to what I'm going to deal in this course. Okay, as somebody rightly quoted, you have been introduced with modulation basics. As you know, a modulation is a process in which a modulator, there is a block called as a modulator changes some attributes. So there can be several attributes of this modulator of a higher frequency carrier signal. So carrier signal is a carrier for a message signal. So it's a carrier for a message signal to carry to a longer distances. I will take a few minutes to have a basic understanding of this modulation again and take a next step further. Okay, so there are two signals here. One is message signal and there is a carrier signal. So message signal is the original information signal per se, and carrier signal, as I told, this is basically the signal which carries the message signal. So why can't message signal itself be transmitted as it is? So there are so many reasons for that. We'll enumerate a few of modulation techniques, reasons for modulation. But before that, if I have a carrier, the carrier is the center point of this modulation. So carrier can be designated with its amplitude. So amplitude is one of the parameters, and frequency is another parameter, and phase. Okay, these are the three attributes. By attribute, I mean the characteristics of a carrier in terms of its amplitude and frequency and phase can be denoted. The modulation is a process in which the modulator, which takes both carrier signal and message signal and try to mix these signals in such a way that some of the attributes of the carrier will change. It can be changed with amplitude, and hence it is called as amplitude modulation. As somebody told, frequency modulation, if you are varying the carrier frequency with respect to message signal, then it's FM. And if you are changing with the phase of the carrier with respect to message signal, it is a phase modulation technique, right? So there are so many reasons, as I told, about modulation. We'll come to this question later. But as you know, if it's an information signal, some random signal which is going along the timeline, and carrier is a smooth sinusoidal waveform which is of a higher frequency compared to the information signal itself, we'll try to change the attributes of the carrier, in particular with the amplitude in this case. So in particular with the amplitude, the carrier signal amplitude will vary in accordance with the information signal. So as you can see, the envelope of the carrier signal just matches with your information signal. So this dotted line is basically is nothing but your information signal, or M of T. So that's what you had studied in your basics of electronics or in your plus one or plus twos. Okay. So this I can take with the little mathematical way to understand more deeper into this before I take the reasons of modulation. Now, if I take the actual mathematical inclusions with this modulation is, say if you have a carrier, say C of t is say AC of AC cos AC cos 2 pi fct, and if I have a message signal, say m of t, which is am say cos 2 pi fmt, usually we'll take with the cosinusoidal or the sinusoidal waveforms, because as you know, Fourier has given or he has given a statement that any signal in under the sun can be represented with the series of sines and cosines. Okay, so it's good that, you know, if you can play around with cosinusoidal or sinusoidal waves, it holds good for other kind of waveforms as well. And so with these two given signals, one is carrier and another is message signal, and we know that the carrier frequency is much larger than the message signal frequency. How do you mix these two signals, or how do you modulate these two signals so that it can be suitable for transmission in the given channel? So the modulation, which can be stated at, I mean, the mathematically you can say the modulated signal in this case, S of t, say S of t can be say can be written as, you want to change the attribute of the carrier with respect to amplitude in case of amplitude modulation. I'm still talking about amplitude modulation here. So we need to change the attribute of the carrier. So carrier amplitude will no more be AC, but it will be simply AC plus M of t, because AC is fixed, the carrier amplitude is fixed. I'm changing the overall amplitude of the carrier with respect, I mean, with an in accordance with the message signal. So AC is fixed. Top of that, in the sense envelope of carrier, will be your message signal. Rest everything will be as it is with respect to your carrier. I mean, with the frequency we are not going to alter. So I'm going to ignore the phase at this point. So phi I'm ignoring, or phi I'm making it to zero, since we are not going to touch anything with the frequency or the phase. So if you do math here, simple substitution of m of t into this expression will give you various frequencies. You might have already plotted that frequency spectrum in your courses, where if this is a frequency scale, this will give you a component at fc, and this will give you a component at fc plus fm, and this will give you a component at fc minus fm. Okay, so the amplitudes of this would be if it is AC, and this accordingly with the amplitude of the message signal will vary. In fact, this in particular, it is given as mu AM by 2, and this is mu AM by 2. So where mu I have introduced, which is nothing but your modulation index. Okay, so I'll not get much detail into this, because since it's the very first class, I don't want to intimidate you with various of mathematical equations right away. I just want to have a warm up about what you have understood about the modulations. All right. So if you have any questions, you can ask in between. I'm happy to answer them. Otherwise, I'll consider everything is fine and I'll go ahead. Okay. So why modulation? The basic question is about modulation here. So why do we need a modulation? Can anybody answer to that question?
For convenient transmission.
Convenient transmission, but can you define the convenience? Can you define?
Sir, while transmitting, we may use different media. So, by making the signal more suitable
to strengthen the
media, we are doing modulation.
Okay. Okay, that's a good answer. I mean, you will be modulating to suitable a certain parameters of the channel. So, the transmission channel could be wired, the transmission channel could be wireless, it could be optical in wire also, it could be copper wired or optical case. or if you can go into very deep, it could be, you know, kind of a photonic communication. So so there are so many different channels that you can think of. So suitably to the channel, as you can extend your answer, so suitable to the bandwidth or the channel characteristics, you'll try to modulate. That's fine. Our, you know, message signal will be completely random in nature, and it may not be suitable well enough to transmit as it is through the channel. Right. That's one of the primary reasons for a modulation. That totally I agree. But predominantly, you know, I can list a couple of reasons for modulation. One is that one reason being, say if there are several users, say total, you know, basically you can take you know, voice signal or speech signal. All these speech signals will vary from, say, around, you know, around 20 hertz to say 20 kilohertz. Say all these speech signals will vary from 20 hertz to 20k. And if you try to transmit all these three signals generated from three users onto the same channel, you will be incurring some problem where each of these signals, since they belong to same bandwidth at the baseband or at the information side, they try to mix with each other and corrupt each other. So how do you take care of such things? So primarily reason about the modulation is, or the idea behind that is, you shift each of these signals into different frequency centers. Say this will be at F1, say this will be at F2, and say if this is at F3 at the frequency scale, you can separate them in the frequency such that they will not crosstalk with each other, for which you need to have modulation. Okay, so this one of the very practical or the primary reason for modulation. Second reason, what strikes to my mind is about the antenna length. Probably you might have studied in your plus one or plus twos as well. So the antenna length, as you know, the length of the antenna is actually directly proportional to the wavelength of the operation. So antenna length, say if this is antenna length, it is proportional to the wavelength of the operation. In fact, it is found that the length of the antenna is approximately equal to lambda over 10. Okay, length of the antenna is approximately equal to lambda over 10. And our information signal, our message signals, will be in the order of, I told you, it will be user-generated signals. It will be in the range of you know, few hertz to few kilohertz. So if I take a mid frequency, say if I take an example of say 100 kilohertz of you know, frequency that user is generated. So if I want to transmit this signal over channel using an antenna, say lambda of this, as you know, this is C over F, and as you know, this is 3 into 10 power 8 over this is 100k. So 100k is 3 into 10 power, 10 power 5. So this is around, you know, 3000 meters. Okay. And if you try to substitute back into our earlier approximation of length of the antenna, you would be wondering, so length of the antenna in this case would be how much? How much this would be approximately?
300 meters,
correct. Just for frequency of 100 kilohertz, you are getting length of the antenna as 300 meters, which is highly impractical to design or to consider into our for transmission. And this is with 100 kilohertz. If you come down to frequency, since wavelength is inversely proportional to the frequency, for the frequencies of several hertz, your antenna length can go up to several kilometers, probably more than 100 kilometers if you do the math. Okay, so this is one of the primary reasons where you need to shift all low frequency message signals to higher frequency signals, or to modulate them into higher frequencies, you need certain techniques. Okay, so these are the two fundamental primary idea behind it. There are so many others. You might have other reasons, but everything will fall on to one of the other two important reasons that I have quoted here. Okay, so this you also might have understood in your earlier semesters or in your other academic years. All right. So, but this communication theory is much, much beyond that. But basic idea is about modulation itself. But not just about modulation, but there are so many other theorems or theories that you know to address in transmission of the signals. Okay. So I'll not get into the actual part of the course right away. As I told, you'll take two classes to at least start with the actual syllabus of this course. But we need to understand a couple of things here. So why we are supposed to take this course? Why Communication System 1, CS1, CS2, CS3, or any courses related to communication theory, or probably the mathematics involved in this, which will be of probability or linear algebra, which comes along with this course. All in all, why need to do study this course? I know that the answer probably is since it is included in your syllabus, you don't have any choice to not to take it, right? So that's a very lame reason to give, but you should understand the actual meaning of introducing this course, especially in your third year. Okay, so we assume that your M1 to M4, whatever you studied in your engineering mathematics, are strong enough, or you might have practiced enough such that your fundamentals of mathematics are strong to understand this course. So this is apt time, or this is correct time to introduce applications of mathematics. This is what engineering is all about. Okay, so this course will give you not only about application of mathematics, but there is something more to it. This course, as you might have already been realizing this in your life already, it is enormous, and normally it's a rapidly growing industry in case of wireless communication, be it wireless or wired communication. It's rapidly growing probably since last two decades. So as you compare with the computer industry, you may say that computer has evolved tremendously, or the inventions using computers or in computers have evolved over the years in a tremendous way. I can say that even communication theory has also grown in parallel to that. Okay, so it's definitely it's comparable in size of the growth in the computer industry. I have just a few snippets of comparison of mobile broadband subscriptions with across the world. As you can see, the world, the green here indicates the average of the world. This is definitely is the developed country which are much ahead with us. So the developing country, as you can take some of the subcontinent countries with the developing nature, in between them, world average is also catching up. So this is the data up to 2014. And this is the mobile broadband subscriptions per 100 inhabitants. Okay, as you can see, per 100, it's around 30. Probably it has been reached to more than 70 now, if you take the case with the 2020. Okay, so probably you'll be touching this point somewhere here for sure. Okay, so this is the rapid growing industry, and there are so many opportunities for you as engineers, and this is a very right time to capture or take in both hands to grab the opportunities offered by the communication companies like listed here. So definitely these are the few vendors which are largest telecommunications equipment manufacturers. This is just a sample. I have taken these samples just to quote the companies which are into semiconductor manufacturing devices. So semiconductor has also grown in parallel to communication, which has together has revolutionized the world. Okay, so to quote few examples, the Qualcomm is one of the first companies to approach RV as well, to recruit young minds of RV. So Qualcomm is a leading company which takes or which demands not only just VLSI or semiconductor knowledge, but also related to communication theory. So the quote or the takeaway from this particular snippets is that the course is not just introduced to intimidate you or to showcase the expertise of faculties. It's definitely not about that, but definitely which will help you to take your career into corporations, or in fact, if you are thinking about higher studies or research to the larger extent. All right. The basic objective of this course is to study communication system aspects are very unique to those systems. So we are not going to cover anything in general. We are going to see some unique aspects of this communication system, especially with mathematical understanding, or the overall the covering of the subject is very specific to the communication systems. And of course, we are going to focus a little on the hardware. So there are chips, or there are processors which do the operations, the mathematical operations, in a more efficient way. We have got DSP kits at our laboratories, which do very complex, or which perform very complex algorithms. So we are going to look such, you know, hardware as well in terms of our laboratory. But of course, there are numerous software like we would be using in this, you know, course as laboratory component, using MATLAB and LabVIEW. So both of these would be used in our laboratory to understand the practical understanding of the theory that we deal here. Of course, we also will have some practice questions or open-ended questions using Python as well. We also have got, you know, plenty of examples which can be simulated using Python libraries. Okay, so this is what is the plan, or the overall picture, or the holistic view about the course. But I have not touched about the actual structure of this course, so I'll take, you know, a few minutes for having a look about the course structure as well. So as I told, this is spanned over three semesters as CS1 in this course, and 2 and 3 will be in 5th and 6th semesters. So this course in 5th semester comes with 5 units. First unit will wholly dedicate, or this kind of acts as a bridge course, or bridge part about modulation. As somebody, you know, answered that you have already gone through frequency modulation theory, but we will have a little more deeper understanding of that modulation technique. And this is basically the last point, or the last time that you will be talking about analog modulation. Okay, so analog modulation is a very primitive, or the theory behind analog modulation is still used in digital communication techniques, but that's the reason it's been introduced in your first semester as well. But we'll not directly jump into digital communication system, but we'll have a part of unit 1 dedicated for analog communication, and we'll take about 3 to 4 classes to complete that. And next 3 hours of this unit will be dedicated to random variables. And as you know, random variables and random processes are a part of communication theory, where everything is random. Even the message signal or the information signal is also random, which originates from the user, and the channel is also completely random. So there are no deterministic there are no models which can be very specifically suit to such kind of randomness. So we need to understand the basic meaning of random variables and random processes. And of course, attached with this is your probability theory. Okay, but we'll not get much into probability theory, but we'll just understand the process involved in random processes. I'm sorry. All right, so with that, unit 2 will be dedicated to beginning of your digital communication. So this is with respect to your Digicom. So we'll begin with the digital communication from unit 2 onwards with line codes as a starting point. One of the important attributes of digital communication is digital multiplexing. Okay, so multiplexing is one of the primary reason for going to digital communication, where you can mix several frequencies and still able to transmit in a channel. So that's how you can think about multiplexing as one of the predominant advantage of digital communication. All right, so with that, we'll move on to unit 3. So unit 3 is about conversion of analog to digital. As you know, the basic information signal is analog in nature. We need to transmit, I mean, we need to transform that to digital in order to transmit over digital channels. So there is an important theorem called as low pass sampling theorem. So we will understand a low pass sampling theorem and what kind of hardware will be used to convert from analog to digital, or ADCs. Okay, this is one of the important part of this unit. Once you convert to digital, we'll try to modulate in a digital fashion. So as you might have studied, analog modulations like amplitude modulations, or you'll be introducing with angle modulation in this course. So likewise, digital also have certain kind of modulations, and we'll be studying the basic type of it. It's called as PCM, or pulse code modulation. Compared to the previous scheme, so we have introduced with the two important encoders in this unit, which are called as vocoders or voice coders, and there is something known as LPC vocoders. Okay, so these are the two conceptual treatments that we are going to apply this pulse code modulation, which will which actually is application of PCM itself. All right, so with that, we'll move on to unit 4, which is information theory, and this is introduced as a mathematical or just a theoretical understanding of information, where the Shannon in the late 1940s, during probably in the Second World War, he invented the theories. It's very absurd to say that theory cannot be invented, but he did so. Shannon, in fact, came up with the fantastic theory behind information, which is a source of all your encryptions. So this theory is also used in cryptography or security, so that the communication is more secure in its transmission. Okay, this is also an added advantage of digital communication. So I'm also parallel listing out the advantages of digital communication along with the description of each unit. So this part will give you idea about how secure can the digital communication system be. Okay. So finally, unit 5 will end with an important part, which is called as error correcting codes. So error correcting codes comes with two flavors. Error correcting codes comes with the linear error, linear block codes, or linear codes, which will be dealt in this CS1 course, and there is something known as convolutional codes. So linear error correcting codes is memoryless. This doesn't come with any memory. However, this convolutional codes comes along with the memory. Okay, so there's a two primary difference between error correcting codes. So this will be studying in CS2. So we'll be basically looking for one type of error correcting code here, which is which are part of this CS1 course. Okay, so any doubts so far?
No, sir.
Okay, I hope people are not sleeping with the late afternoon. I understand the late afternoons are quite dull, but she'll have to be with me and help me out whether it's clear with you or not. Okay, so has already listed few advantages of digital transmission. It's just part of me to summarize this. So digital hardware, as you know, it has become so cheap, reliable, and it comes with a pocket sized devices. So these are very miniaturized systems which cannot be realized if you are still in analog transmission. Okay, so these are predominantly practical to apply. As I told, this also comes with an added security and more immunity to noise, and of course with external interferences like jammers. So digital transmission gives with all such flexibilities to play around. Okay, and as I told in the fifth unit, you will be introduced with error detection and correction. Digital transmission helps in that way. In analog communication, if you incur any errors, or if signal is corrupted with the noise, you will not be able to recover the original signal so easily. okay, and you'll not never be realizing where the signal is lost or how the signal is lost. So in case of digital transmission, you can detect the errors. There are so many algorithms for it, and also you can correct those errors and recover the original signal. Okay, so digital transmission is primarily important with that perspective. Okay, so if you're talking about digital communication system, this is an intimidating block diagram. I don't expect you to remember right away, but this is what we are going to cover in three legs of this communication system. I'll just take away what is required for us. I'll not try to explain everything in this, which may be a little complex to cover in a very less amount of time. As I can say, the information source which is introduced at the input of the complete communication system, first thing is to format this. So we are going to study in this formatting in your second unit, as I had mentioned in your core structure, like you'll be introducing with, as I told, if I just have to make a reference of it, your basically unipolar, polar, bipolar, or in general it is called as line codes. So the second unit, it deals with the first part of this digital communication block diagram itself. So all this pulse coding, as I can say, is nothing but your formatting. Okay, then as you can see here, all these shaded blocks are optional, and the unshaded blocks are essential. So we'll right now I'll not cover all these as optional blocks. Unit 3 will directly, if say this is unit 2, unit 3 directly comes with pulse modulation. So this is nothing but your pulse coded modulation or all PCM techniques. Okay, so this is with respect to the third unit. And the fourth unit is about information theory. The information theory mostly deals with source encoding and encryption part. So it comes with the interface of these two, where you try to encode the source and try to identify what kind of information the actual message signal has, and try to we'll not get into the encryption techniques per se, but we'll have a feel about how the source can be secured with the information theory. It is about fourth unit. And the fifth unit we are going to cover as error correcting or detecting and error corrections. So that can happen with channel encoding. So that is called as channel encode, where you will try to encode to the channel, where channel will try to corrupt the signal. So to suitable to the channel, how the channel is going to behave, in that way we are going to choose appropriate algorithm appropriate algorithm to our encrypted signal to transmit over further parts of communication channel. All right. So of course this is also multiplexing, which is part of second unit. We'll also cover this. So as you can see, I have covered most all of the units except that random theory, which is a part of entire thing, where if you take the channel itself, it's the channel is will be behaving completely randomly, and even information source is also random in nature. So that's a part of this complete course. So I cannot say or pinpoint where the particular theorems will be applied. All right, so this is about your CS1. So if I just try to brief about what you would be going to study in your CS2, probably that's not the part of this course anyway, but to just to give an idea, you will be covering band pass modulation, which is actually will be suited to high frequency signals. As you can see, up to here it is a baseband waveform. Until that we feed with band pass, it is still in the very low frequency domain. We are going to transform into very high frequency domain using band pass modulation theories. So band pass modulation theory is the first unit of your CS2 course itself, and also we are going to study the spread spectrums techniques or the jamming techniques or the multiple access that was the one of the generations in wireless communication as CDMA, which is code division multiple access. So that was also that is evolved with you know, 3G's and 4G's now, and in fact 5G is also getting rolled out. So at end of CS2 we'll also be introduced with such kind of technologies. You may be wondering why I'm just, you know, concentrating only on the top part of this. Correct. So the top part is completely the transmission. Should we talk about the receiver as well? Yes, of course. The answer is, you know, without receiver, how you are going to demodulate the signal and understand it or interpret what is sent from the transmitter. Okay. So that receiver does the job exact in a reverse way of the transmission. As you can correlate with each of the blocks, it keeps on doing the reverse process as a transmission, but it is not so simple. The receiver job is much, much complex when compared to transmission. In your CS2 course, you'll be basically concentrating on how to demodulate and sample, and how to detect and how to decode, and finally how to decode into the origin message symbols. Okay, so much of the theories in your CS2 will be concentrated upon the receiver part. Here we are going to concentrate much on the transmission part. That's how this course is spanned into two parts. In the third part, you will be talking the recent trends in communication with respect to LTE and 5G's. That's a different different concepts altogether, which cannot be designated anywhere in this complete communication system. Any questions now? I hope all are awake.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. So let us go ahead and have a feel of the first part of this course, which is angle modulation. So as I told, the first part of this unit is your angle modulation itself. Which is nothing but a non-linear type of non-linear modulation unlike linear modulation of amplitude variations. Okay, so we'll talk about non-linear modulation. I'll just have a glimpse or give an introduction to angle modulation, and I'll end today's session so that we can pick from where we had left off, and it will be easy to understand in later sessions. Okay, so let me talk about angle modulation. So this is part of the derivation. I'll switch back to my pad. Okay, so the angle modulation, you can also note down in parallel with me. Of course, this will be shared with you, but if you are with me, then it will be easy to understand. As I told, this will be little rigorous in mathematics, because it's not just the statements or the theorems that you are going to study. Along with the equations and interpretations, this course will be more interesting. And I'll make sure I'll promise that how far maybe the course would be intimidating based on the feedbacks from your seniors, I'll make this course relatively easier or simpler. Yes, somebody was asking me a question.
Sir, can you repeat the same thing what I told you again, sir? Your voice is not audible.
Your voice is not so clear. What part you want me to repeat?
Sir, right from you wrote to sir, angle modulation on the feet.
Now I'll start. That's what I was saying. But please be with me. Listen like a movie or something. Please be with me so that you will understand the actual concepts behind that. It's not just the equations that I'm going to write, but the interpretations of those equations also is going to be important. Okay, that's what I said, nothing more than that. Okay, is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So the angle modulated wave, or the actual modulated wave with respect to the angle, if it can be represented as, say, S of t and AC cos, say, phi I of t, say, I'll take this, sorry. say this is AC cos say phi of t. Say if this is an angle modulated wave, so this is my, if this is my angle modulated wave, okay, what does each of these parameters indicate? So here theta I of t, so the theta I of t here, this represents, of course, this represents the angle of the modulated wave, and AC of course is the amplitude of that. So since it's angle modulation, you are not going to look anything for the amplitude, as I had briefed about amplitude modulation, where the attribute of the carrier in terms of amplitude was varying. Now we will be focusing upon the angle of the carrier signal. So if this is the angle modulated wave, so I can say here as well, this is carrier amplitude. Since I've written angle, I'll try to represent carrier as well. Okay, so if this angle, this theta it or phi of t, it's rather I use the theta it for to be in accordance with the textbook standards. So I'll be using theta I of t. So if this theta I of t, say if this theta I of t is linear in nature, say if this theta I t with respect to time, say if it is linear, say if the angle is increasing or decreasing with the linear, then I can take two intervals. Say if this is an interval, say some random interval t at this point and t plus delta t at this point, such that the difference between these two is delta t. Okay, so if angle of a modulated signal, if it is linearly varying with respect to time, then I can write an equation in this fashion, where theta I of t plus delta t, which is the farthest point, in the sense the theta at this point and theta at this point, minus theta I of t over delta t. So what does this represent? This is rate of change of angle, or the angle of the modulated signal with respect to time. So if angle is represented in radians, so this is the unit of radians per second. So this is the rate of change of angle in radians per second. We know this is nothing but angular frequency. So angular frequency I can represent this as omega delta t. Okay, so with omega representing the frequency in radians per second, which can be further be written as 2 pi f delta t. So this f subscript delta t indicates that you are talking the variations of the angle in the interval delta t. Okay, so if I try to rearrange the terms here, I would get f delta t as theta I minus theta I of t over 2 pi. Okay, so if I call this as equation 1, so if I try to call this as equation 1, let us keep it aside and we'll try to continue the derivation or the understanding of angle modulation. So this is the rearrangement of my frequency in the interval as mentioned in the diagram. So the frequency in between this interval is represented by this. Say if I want to find
so
out,
you have left delta t.
I'm sorry,
so you have left delta t.
Okay, I'm sorry, thank you man. Good. Okay, so this is f delta t. This is not, in fact, of t. So this should be written as in precisely f delta t of t. Okay, so this is the rearrangement of the expression. So if I want to find out the actual values or the instantaneous values within this interval, if I had to find out the frequency at certain time, not with the range. So as you know, with the basic differentiation theory, the instantaneous frequency f I of t can always be written as a limit as delta t tending to 0 f delta t of t. Correct. So as delta t tends to 0, as this interval becomes smaller and smaller, it will converge into a single point. So that's what this meaning, where if you want to find out an instantaneous frequency, so this is the instantaneous frequency. If I want to represent, I'm sorry, this should have come here. So the instantaneous frequency can be written in this fashion. Substituting f delta t from this equation, you will be, I mean, you can write this as limit delta t tends to 0, the complete expression of f delta t, which is nothing but theta I t plus delta t minus theta I of t whole divided by 2 pi. Okay, so this can be further be, yes.
Just 2 pi, sir.
Yes, one by one.
Sir, doesn't delta t come in the denominator?
Sorry?
Doesn't delta t come in the denominator, sir?
Delta t is a subscript. It just represents, this is representation as f delta t. This is not f into delta t. This
No, sir, no, sir. You see
No,
the
sir.
expression of the omega delta t.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Okay. So here was delta t. So here should also be 2 pi delta t and 2 pi delta t. I hope that's correct. Okay. Yeah. Thank you for correcting. All right. So with that, I can concisely write this as limit as delta t tending to 0. So this is nothing but sorry, this is nothing but the definition of your basic differentiation, where limit delta t tending to 0 with this difference of two numbers with the 2 pi delta t, which can be concisely written as 1 over 2 pi. So 1 over 2 pi can be taken out. So this is nothing but your definition of the variation of theta I itself with respect to. Okay, so this is how you can represent the instantaneous frequency. So this will be useful in analyzing in the next session. So this fi of t can be concisely written as 1 over 2 pi into d theta I of t by dt. Okay, so with that, now you can check back the equation earlier, where you had the equation 1. So I'll call this equation as 2. I'll call this equation as 2. So if you try to compare, the equation 1 and equation 2, the equation 1, there is theta I of t, which represents the angle, the time rate of change of this angle, or the s of t, which is angular modulated wave, is nothing but it's a phasor of amplitude AC rotating with an angular speed of theta I of t. Okay, so this is nothing but, and you can say this is nothing but, say this is nothing but in the phasor diagram, this is nothing but with an amplitude of AC, this vector is rotating with an angular speed of theta I of t. Okay, so we can represent angle modulated wave in this fashion as well. Okay, so with that understanding, the time rate of change of theta I of t, we know that this is the this is nothing but our frequency in radians per second, or the angular frequency itself. According to the equation, the second equation, we can write theta I of t as, I'll completely write this. So from the second equation, how can we write theta I of t? Theta I of t is nothing but the integration on the both the sides, or other words, I'll rewrite this expression, 1 over 2 pi d theta I of t over dt. As you know, this is now my instantaneous frequency. Now this implies theta I of t is nothing but 2 pi integral of f I of t. Okay, so this I can, since it's an instantaneous frequency, so of course this is an instantaneous frequency, so I can write this integral as 2 pi times, say, some frequency, I'll call that as carrier frequency itself, 2 pi fct plus some constant. Okay, that some constant can be anything, so I'll designate it as phi c. Okay, so this is my instantaneous angle, or this is expression for instantaneous frequency, this is an expression for instantaneous angle. So these two equations will be helpful for later analysis. Okay, any doubts at this point? It's just a rearrangement of the quantities here, nothing more I have done. Just to say that theta I of t is nothing but or otherwise I need not have used this expression. I would have directly said, since this is the angle modulated wave, we know that theta of t can be represented as omega t plus some phase. So omega t I have represented as 2 pi fct, and that plus for some phase I have designated as some carrier phase. Okay, so this can also be this could have been also written in a straightforward way, but we took the longer route just to understand that, just to express the quantity of instantaneous frequency and instantaneous angle in this angle modulated wave. So this is, everything is fine under the condition where we don't have any message signal. So for m of t is equal to zero, since we are just talking about the carrier, this is, everything is okay as long as my I don't have any message signal. Now my job is, when m of t is not equal to zero, m of t when it is varying, how do I vary the quantities of the angle? Since it's an angle modulation, this is the instantaneous angle. How do I change the attributes of the angle in accordance with the message signal? Okay, so that's the question. So this can be done in a infinite number of ways. I can vary my angle, instantaneous angle of the modulated wave, in accordance with the message signal in a numerous ways, but we'll be looking for only two specific types in the first half of this unit. The first half of this unit deals with the frequency modulation and phase modulation. Okay, so I can say that the frequency modulation is that if you change frequency of the carrier in accordance with the message, it will be frequency modulated signal. If you change phase of the carrier in accordance with the message signal, then it is called as phase modulated signal. Okay, so this is the right point where I can stop my session and take forward in the next class, where we'll be dealing precisely with phase modulation and frequency modulation, and look for more aspects of this angle modulated waves. So if you have any question, I'll give the platform to answer your questions.
Sir, what do you mean when you say non-linear modulation? Okay. Like the phase is...
Okay. So if it's a non-linear modulation, which I'll be taking actually in a next session, why it is called as a non-linear. The theta I of t is basically is hidden. I mean, the frequency and the phase information is hidden in the argument of the cos. So if I go back to the expression, the frequency and the message, the frequency and the phase is hidden in the argument of cos. So cos of some angle, if I say m of t is varying if f of t is some signal which is randomly varying, the argument of the cos will also be randomly varying. So it is not just a uniform variation of overall modulated signal. Okay, so it's a if I have to be more specific to your question, I can show the frequency and I can show the waveforms of the angle modulated wave. So I will pick this again in the next session. So as you can see in amplitude modulated wave, the amplitude of the modulated wave is varying with some uniform distribution. Say for negative amplitudes, it will have lesser amplitudes. For positive, it will have some other amplitude. But in case of FM or PM, in case of frequency modulated or phase modulated signal, as you can see, the variations are not so smooth. So in some quantity of the message signal, the cycles are closer. In some other amplitude of the signal, the cycles are far away. So the non-linearity comes in a fashion that it cannot be seen or visually so smooth like your amplitude modulated wave. We'll deal with this actual mathematical where why it is non-linear. So you know the superposition principle from your signal system theory. We'll prove that the angle modulated wave is not linear in nature. I'll take that precisely in next session. Will that be okay? Is it fine? I didn't hear from you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. As a reminder, I'll be taking or capturing the attendance in automated fashion in this Google Meet. So make sure that you will be staying throughout the session. So this recording will happen in a very nice way where I can display here just to represent. See, these are all the people who are present during what session. So please make sure that you will attend the session from beginning to the end. So even if you go away and come back and join at the end of the session, that will also be recorded. Okay, so please make sure that your presence in the class is from beginning to end. All right, so I'll just check the chat box if I have any questions from here. Okay.
Oh, sir. So,
yes, yes.
What is the IN, theta I and F? IFT signal.
Okay, so where you are exactly pointing to?
In anywhere really. You mentioned theta I of t and f I of t.
Okay, I is nothing but it's instantaneous.
Instantaneous
value. Instantaneous by which I mean it's the value at that particular instant. So f I of t represents the value of the frequency at that particular time. As you can see in the frequency modulated waveform, the frequency is not constant throughout the time. So you need to find out what is the frequency at that particular point of instant of time.
Okay.
That's the reason we need to have the instantaneous value of the frequency as well as instantaneous value of the angle to define frequency modulated and phase modulated waveforms.
Okay.
Okay, any more questions? I'll be happy to take. I just want to know who is the CR of this class, section. Amrit, okay. Amrit, I'll drop. I think I'm already there in your 5A section. I am the one who messaged about the CS1 class in the afternoon. So my contact is there. Please make that okay. Fine, then we'll meet tomorrow at around 3. Please make sure that you join little early compared to today so that everybody will be benefited out of this. Okay, if there is no other question, I can end the session. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.